Welcome to episode 154 of the Various Sundry Podcast. I am your host, Matt Harmon, joined live from the Vault Studio from the beautiful campus of Grace College and Theological Seminary by my good friend, my colleague, my co-host, and the man who is planning a move, John Scott Sloat.
Doc, what's happening today?
Well, first, I just want to note how cold it is in the studio today.
Yep. A combination of things. When students leave campus, the heat somehow gets turned down.
Yes.
Every single time.
Yes.
And it's cold outside.
It is. Yes. So, but as I mentioned in my open, you are on the cusp of planning a move.
Yeah, yeah. Andrew and I came to an agreement pending inspection with on a house in Fort Wayne.
Okay.
So we're planning to be up there somewhat into the new year.
Okay. All right. Well, that's a big deal.
Yep. Yep. Feels big. Anytime you start thinking about 30 years of payments.
Yeah.
What am I doing? You know, yeah. But I already had one of those deals.
Right.
You know.
Yeah. So you're just pushing the clock back.
Three years.
Yeah. You've paid on the current house 3 years, so you're just kind of—
Had some extra payments in there as well.
Yeah. Got some equity now, so yeah.
Yep. And so just what's nice is when you go from one house to the next house, you just kind of bring that equity with you.
Yeah.
And put it into the next house. And you're like, oh, this is more affordable than I thought.
Yeah. Equity's a beautiful thing.
It's weird. Money and wealth.
Yeah.
Odd things.
It is. Good things.
Yeah.
Good things when they work in your favor. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Capitalism at play.
That's right. John Scott Sloat, capitalist at heart.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, Christian at heart. Let's be clear.
Okay.
You know, Christ follower.
A Christian capitalist, not a capitalist Christian.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, yes, Christian foremost, but capitalist. Sure, I'll take that.
Okay. All right.
I'm pro-capitalist.
Good. So am I. If you would like to reach out and discuss more about John Scott Sloat's capitalist preferences, you can find us on Twitter at VNSPod. Email the show, variousandsundrypodcast@gmail.com. We are on Facebook. We are on YouTube. And as always, we would appreciate a 5-star rating and a friendly review.
Yep, always. Always. And tell a friend.
Yeah, tell a friend.
Have some human connection.
I mean, you're going to be around more people around the holidays here.
Oh, yeah.
Casual conversation, mention it. Hey, you might be interested in this podcast that I listen to regularly.
Yeah. When things get awkward at Christmas dinner,
yeah,
just put us on the Bluetooth speaker and jam up the volume.
Absolutely.
A little VNS pod to bring the peace.
Yes. That's what we do. We bring people together.
That's right.
Yes. All right, let's talk some sports, John.
Okay.
The only college football note is that the Heisman Trophy was awarded this past weekend to USC quarterback Caleb Williams, which was not really much of a surprise.
Yeah, he's had it locked up for a little bit, hasn't he?
Not about locked up, but I would say the last few weeks of the season he was the front runner. That's probably right. C.J. Stroud of Ohio State finished third. So that was his second year as a finalist. Let's talk Jets, NFL football. Let's talk your J-E-T-S, Jets.
Yep. Lost for the second week in a row.
Yes.
To a very good team.
Yeah.
So we played two very good teams, and we played them, I think, very tough.
Mm-hmm.
So we had the ball with a chance to win the game, and we weren't able to pull it out. But I'm encouraged coming out of those two games that we played very, very tough.
And do you think that Mike White is the answer at quarterback moving forward?
Yes.
Okay.
I think so. I mean, he's 1-2. Now, the two is against Buffalo and Minnesota.
Yeah. Two very good teams
this year. Two very good teams that he played very tough.
Yeah.
So I want to see him in there the rest of the season. The coaching staff won't commit to that. Now, I don't know if you saw some of the hits he took on Sunday.
Oh, he was getting blasted.
But it's amazing he did not just break in half. Also, there's a lot of complaints that the Jets aren't getting the roughing the passer calls that I think those were legal hits against Mike White.
The ones I saw looked legal, yeah.
But the ones I saw in other games also looked legal that were considered roughing the passer.
Yeah. It's roughing the passer in the NFL is almost, not quite, almost as bad as targeting in college football.
Mm-hmm.
It's so inconsistently enforced and interpreted, and it's one of those things where you look at a hit and you're like, I don't know. By the rule, is that roughing? I guess maybe technically by the strictest letter of the law. But, you know, you see some of these where a defensive lineman comes in and tries to, like, knock the pass down, and then his hand on his way down, like, brushes the helmet of the quarterback.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, there's roughing the passer. Really?
By the way, Garrett Wilson, I don't know if you saw this tweet like an hour ago, but he tweeted out there was somebody complaining that the Jets receivers were getting lit up and hit. And Garrett Wilson chimed in and goes, yeah, I haven't gotten a call all year. And I asked one ref, why not? And he goes, this isn't Ohio State anymore.
Okay.
I felt snarky. I don't like my referees snarky.
No.
I like them strong and silent.
And I would simply say Ohio State wide receivers don't tend to get calls anyway. So
yeah.
let's have an accurate perception of what's going on there. So, yeah, I mean, they seem to have found a running back.
Bam Knight. Don't you love that name?
It's a great name.
They just need to keep giving him the ball. He only had 17 carries on Sunday. I would like to see him 25, I think.
Okay.
Carries. I'd like to see a few more carries. I think they throw the ball to Braxton Berrios way too much. That's like their fourth option.
Yeah.
Like, and he got targeted like six times. He needs to be targeted like twice a game. He's a punt returner at the end of the day.
Right. Yeah. You need to be getting the ball to Wilson and Elijah. What's his last name?
Moore.
Elijah Moore.
Agreed. Denzel Mims as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's a huge guy.
Yeah.
Tacklers bounce off him. So, yeah, we just need more of that.
Okay. Yeah, so who do they have next?
We got the Lions and the Jaguars.
Both games that you should be favored in.
Against the Lions, only by 1.5 at home.
The Lions are one of those sneaky teams that feels like they're in every game.
Yeah.
And they did beat the Vikings this past weekend.
Did they?
Mm-hmm. So, and they did get Jameson Williams on the field finally, their first-round wide receiver pick who – tore his ACL in the national championship game last year. And on his first NFL catch, it was a like 45-yard touchdown pass.
Wow.
So it was kind of like he was back at Alabama, running wide open in open spaces and not – like he's very good. Don't get me wrong. He's really, really good.
Yeah.
But he's not this like precise route runner where you're like, oh, man, he's got the technical skills. He's just – crazy fast. And so he ends up getting a lot of catches utilizing his speed. But yeah,
well,
he's a good addition for the Lions.
The Vikings have one of the worst passing defenses in the league.
Yeah.
We'll see how he does against, you know, one of the top three or four passing defenses in the league.
Yeah.
And we'll see how Jared Goff does with, you know, 12 defensive linemen coming at him.
Yeah.
Looking to bring him to the ground.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Yep. We'll see how that goes.
Okay.
And then hopefully we can do the same to Trevor Lawrence.
Yeah. Did anybody see the Eagles going 12-1 to start the year?
I don't think so, but I don't think anybody saw Jalen Hurts playing as well as he has.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, if we went, oh, Jalen Hurts going to have an MVP level season, I think you'd go, oh, is he? Well, you know, maybe the Eagles are pretty good.
Yeah.
They're not that far removed from a Super Bowl.
Yeah.
I shudder to think what happens to the Eastern Seaboard if they win another Super Bowl. My goodness.
Yeah. Philly fans are a little unhinged.
Yeah. I would like to remove the word little.
Yeah. Fair enough. Anything else in the NFL that caught your attention this weekend?
Baker Mayfield came into the Rams game to win.
Yeah.
Weird.
Yep.
Good for Baker,
I guess. I was never a big Baker fan, so.
Well, you know, it's always, when you can come in on Tuesday and play on Thursday and win the game.
Yeah.
That's impressive.
It is. It is.
Probably tells me he's not a great preparer, but probably a pretty good reactor.
Yeah. Yeah. Great in backyard football.
Mm-hmm.
He'd be the guy you'd want on your team in a backyard football game.
Yep.
Let's see. World Cup. We're down to the semis now. Did you see any of the quarterfinal matches?
Nope, not a one. United States is out of it.
Yeah.
I've sort of
the England against France matchup.
Was good?
Very good.
That's heartbreaking for England.
It was – well, and the way that it happened too was they got down 1-0 and then managed to get a penalty in the box. Harry Kane, their best player, takes it, scores. France goes up 2-1, and then there's like in the 83rd minute, England gets another penalty in the box. Harry Kane has a penalty, misses it, skies it.
Puts it over the goal.
Puts it over the goal.
Oh, my. Harry Kane.
Harry Kane. So I felt bad for my my British friend, Ben. Ben in the UK.
Nottingham.
Yes. Ben and I were texting a bit during the game. And I felt bad because my feed was a little ahead of his. So I spoiled the second French goal for him. So
that's got to be heartbreaking too.
Yeah, he was watching it. He was watching it at his vicar's house.
Of course, as one does.
Yeah, I mean, obviously.
I mean, good thing there's no rivalry between France and England ever. You know, they've never fought wars or anything like that.
No.
And they just always—it's a big love fest between the French and the English.
Yeah, absolutely. Always get along so well.
Yep.
So yeah, the semifinals are set. You have France playing against Morocco, the Cinderella of the tournament.
Yeah, from what I understand, it's the first African country to get into the semifinals.
That's correct.
That's pretty exciting.
Yeah. So France
Casablanca.
Against Morocco, which, I mean, if you know your geography—
They're not that far apart.
They're very close.
Yep.
Just across the is that still technically the Mediterranean where it meets?
Well, that'd be Spain that's right across that little strait there, right?
Is it? Yeah.
So it'd be like – it'd be across the Mediterranean a little bit. Yeah. You'd have to go a little northwest.
That's right.
Northeast, excuse me.
Yeah, northeast.
Sorry. Other side of the world.
Yes.
Or at least a quarter of it.
So France against Morocco and then Croatia against Argentina.
Yeah, it feels like there's Croatia, a bit of a Cinderella, right?
A little bit. Not to the same level as Morocco, but yeah.
The Balkans, right? Croatia's in the Balkans, right? Is that?
I think so.
Yeah, if I understand Eastern European geography, that's where Croatia is.
Which is an open question.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's nowhere near Argentina. I can report that.
We can definitely confidently say that it's nowhere near Argentina, yes.
So, yeah, looking forward to it. I'm not going to watch. I'll check the scores at the end.
Okay. Yeah, I think my frustration with soccer is always the, let's play. Okay, we play 90 minutes. No one's ahead. Now we play another 30 minutes. We're still tied. And now we do penalty kicks.
Mm-hmm. The exciting moments, though, in soccer are really exciting.
Yeah, punctuated by long stretches of
opportunity to go to the bathroom, get a drink, whatever you need to do.
It is good background noise, especially – here's the thing. Especially if you have the ability to pause and then rewind live TV. Mm-hmm. Throw that thing on in the background. You miss a goal. Oh, well. Flip it back 15 seconds. There it is. Okay. I saw it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, yeah, have you started paying any attention to basketball yet, NBA or college?
I know the Knicks are 500. I look at scores. That's about it.
All right.
I know they're talking Knicks trades already, so that can't be good.
Probably not.
Obi Toppin's out.
Oh.
Injured.
That's tough.
That's about all I got for you. I did get a new piece in my office. I've had it for a while, but I just brought to my office an autographed Allen Houston picture.
Okay.
That's now in my office.
How did you get that?
I don't remember.
uh-oh, sorry.
I don't remember. I can't remember if I won it at a – you know, I went to one charity golf event when I was in high school.
Okay.
I don't know how I did this, but I went – it was me and the buddies on the golf team mm-hmm. went and played a charity golf tournament, and they had a silent auction. I saw the Allen Houston thing, and I saw no bids, and it was early in the day, and I was like, oh, I'll throw down 10 bucks. I threw down 10 bucks. Yes, I think this is coming back to me, and I won it for $10 because nobody – this was in Georgia. Nobody wanted this.
Yeah. Yeah. How did they end up with that?
I have no idea. I couldn't even tell you what the charity was for. I just knew I was going to play golf.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
Playing a scramble.
There you go. All right. We ready to move on, John?
Sure.
So our main topic for today in light of the Christmas season is we're going to talk Christmas movies.
Yes.
Christmas movies. Now, are you a big Christmas movie guy?
I wouldn't say so. I don't think I've seen many of them.
Okay.
But I do have some that I continually come back to.
Okay.
And that's – you took one of them, so I've removed it from my list. I'll let you try to figure out which one that was.
Okay.
And I inserted another one that I enjoy. So keep it – so we have five totally different lists.
All right.
Of Christmas lists.
Yeah.
Of Christmas movies.
Yeah. What about Andrea? Is she big into the Christmas movie thing or not?
She likes Christmas movies. We were talking about this yesterday, and I think she would have Elf on here. I do not have Elf.
Neither do I.
She really likes that movie. What's funny is she'll watch movies on her day off, like when she's home alone and I'm at work. She'll just pop on a Christmas movie, do something else, and work.
Okay.
So, yes, she's a bigger Christmas movie person than I am.
All right. I am not a huge Christmas movie person. That doesn't make me a Grinch, but don't tend to be a huge Christmas movie person. But there are some good Christmas movies. We could talk about those. Side note, what about Hallmark movies around Christmas time? I know you're not into those.
No.
Is Andrea into those at all?
Do you have to have the Hallmark channel to get those?
Maybe. I don't know.
So we don't have cable, so that hasn't become an issue. But okay. – The generic sort of big time chick flick Christmas movie.
Yeah.
Maybe we've watched one since we've been married.
Okay.
That's been it. So yeah. No, I wouldn't say so.
Yeah.
I imagine you guys aren't.
No, we're not.
Okay. I didn't think so.
No. They're eminently mockable for the most part.
Well, that sounds like a good time.
Utterly predictable. So anyway, okay. So part of this was prompted by the fact that we are doing a sort of Christmas movie marathon in our home.
Oh.
Because of Jake's girlfriend, Autumn, is staying with us this week. And so she is much more into the Christmas movie, Christmas.
So has she curated a list for you?
Well, we've all contributed.
Okay.
So it's sort of a group project in terms of coming up with the list.
And what movie are you watching tonight?
So tonight we're watching Claws.
Is that like a horror slasher Christmas movie?
Not
like
that I'm aware
Claws,
of.
Claws, C-L-A-W-S?
I believe it's K-L-A-U-S.
Okay. Is it German?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay.
It's apparently – it's on Netflix and comes pretty highly acclaimed. In fact, we'll probably get into this a little bit, but you found a list of the 100 best – Christmas movies, which has some very interesting choices on it, but it put Claws as number 5 all time, and it's been out since 2019.
That feels like a stretch.
That feels like it might be a bit early for that. So that's what we're gonna watch tonight. So we'll see how that is. But all right, let's start with we'll go back and forth here. What's your – I didn't necessarily list mine in the order.
No, neither did I.
So this isn't necessarily like your favorite or what you think is the best, but we do have a list, each of us, of 5. So hit me with your first one here.
So probably the movie that brings the most nostalgia to me is The Grinch.
Okay.
And I've listed – I mean certainly the cartoon and the Jim Carrey version.
Yeah.
I haven't really seen the new one. There's a new animated one. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
Yeah, it's on. I think it's on Netflix. But The cartoon one, my parents had a VHS with The Grinch, Charlie Brown's Christmas, Frosty the Snowman, and my dad would record it on TV and pause the recording during all the commercials.
You want to explain for some of our younger listeners what a VHS is? They may not know.
It's like a cassette tape, but with video.
Yes. Yes, there you go.
See how I use like a term they definitely wouldn't know?
Right. Super helpful.
Yeah, yeah.
Super
an old tape cassette.
Yeah.
Is what
yeah.
it was.
Yeah.
And so when you recorded it, if you were recording live TV, you would record it and you would get the commercials. My dad sat at the VCR and hit pause and cut out all the commercials from this.
That's some commitment.
Yeah, yeah. It was – I think it was early in the marriage.
Props to Scott Sloat.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Love the Grinch.
I am familiar with the story. I'm trying to remember if I've actually seen any of the Grinch movies. I don't know that I have.
Jim Carrey was really good
yeah,
in it.
Yeah, I bet.
Have you seen that one?
I mean, don't think so. I don't know that I have.
One of the things I loved about the cartoon version mm-hmm. was I loved just like sort of, you know, like a Rube Goldberg machine where, yeah. where you put a marble here and it causes this other thing over here to happen mm-hmm. through like a series of 40 or 45 steps.
Yeah.
They basically had those in The Grinch where you had balls running through tunnels in different directions and all these things. And I think as a child, I think I just looked at that and loved it.
Okay.
So that was part of, that was – so Grinch has a lot of nostalgia for me.
There you go. The first one on my list is Christmas Vacation, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
Oh, yeah. This was the one I took off my list.
Now, side note, there's a little content in there.
Yeah.
So just a little warning. Yep. I'd forgotten about some of the
yep.
content in there because it's been a while since I've seen it. But yeah, I mean Chevy Chase is just funny.
Mm-hmm.
And the scene, the repeated efforts to light up the Christmas lights outside, just it makes me laugh every time.
Yeah, yeah.
So
that's a good one.
It is.
I did remove that one from my list because I did have that one on my list.
Yeah,
but decided we shouldn't double dip, and it would be more interesting.
And the even just the family dynamics. You know, in that movie.
Yeah, he talks about stapling his head to the floor. Zach in Ohio is a big fan of this movie and quotes it all the time.
Yeah. Yeah, it's – and even the, you know, the kids and what's his – is it his brother that shows up in the RV?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I couldn't be more surprised if I woke up and my head was stapled to the floor. Yeah. You know, something like that. Yes. I'm sure Zach is going to correct me.
Probably. Probably. What's your next one here, John?
The Santa Claus.
I've heard of it. I'm not familiar
with
it.
This is Tim Allen, yeah. Disney 90s.
Okay.
Where Tim Allen is sort of this divorced parent and trying to co-parent with his ex-wife and has his kid for, I think, Christmas Eve. And they go out, you know, they go to bed, mm-hmm. they go out. Santa has fallen off the roof and died on their front stoop and then just sort of magically disappears. He puts on the suit, becomes Santa Claus,
all right.
and he's like rebelling against this, being Santa Claus, and eventually I won't spoil it for you, but
okay.
Is Santa Claus. And they made two sequels after that, and they just came out with a series on Disney Plus. I have not watched the series, but
okay.
the first one's really good. We watched it again recently,
okay.
and it was awesome.
Yeah. All right. So the second one on my list is Home Alone.
Very good. Classic movie.
Classic. Classic. Again, I love the family dynamics in that one as well. It is funny to see you know, Macaulay Culkin.
Mm-hmm.
Like to remember, this is why he became a big deal.
Oh, yeah.
Because now he's basically made a train wreck of his life.
Oh, yeah.
And so it can be easy to forget like, wow, he was a really good, cute, you know, little kid.
Oh, yeah.
And did a good job with that movie.
I remember that movie having like ads throughout it. Like I think they had like Brute Cologne or something like that. And it's clearly framed in the shot.
Yeah.
He's putting it on. And
yeah. Strategic product placement.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, for sure. Yeah, and even just his, you know, the whole Joe Pesci is in there mm-hmm. trying to outsmart the thieves and
as a child that was obsessed with Rube Goldberg sorts of things, that movie was awesome.
Yes, yeah, and even just the you know, the neighbor that he's introduced early in the movie is, you know, he got away with killing his family and, you know, stuff, you know, burying them in the backyard or something like that. And so he's this kind of scary figure. And of course, he's not really that way. It has a warm-hearted conversation with Kevin in a church.
Mm.
So, yeah. That to me is one of the best Christmas movies, Home Alone.
I enjoy Home Alone. It's on Disney Plus right now.
It is.
All right. Ready for my number three here?
Yep, let's do it.
Okay. A Christmas Carol.
Yep.
The 1984 version. Starring George C. Scott.
All right.
I have to be that explicit because there's so many versions right. of that movie.
Yes.
It feels like one comes out every year.
Yeah.
Have you ever read the book, A Christmas Carol?
I probably have. I don't remember, but I probably have.
I think I'm going to peruse it this Christmas. So I think I'm going to at least audiobook it through just to give it a good read because I've never done it. But – my family always watched A Christmas Carol, 1984, with George C. Scott just about every year.
Yeah.
We've watched that.
Okay.
And I've tried to find updated ones. There's not really a good one out there. George C. Scott is just really magnificent as an actor.
Yeah, he is. He is. By the way, going back to Christmas Vacation, one thing I meant to mention and forgot, I didn't remember that the neighbor next door,
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's Elaine from Seinfeld.
Yep. It's Elaine from Seinfeld.
I don't think I'd ever put that together. It's been so long since I'd seen it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. So it's funny to see some of these. And I think is it and the mom from Everybody Loves Raymond is one of the family members in that as well. Okay. My third one. This is controversial to some.
I'm okay with it.
I am too. Die Hard.
Yeah. It takes place at a Christmas party.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I think it's a Christmas movie.
I think so too. I mean, it's a different genre of Christmas movie,
for sure.
Right? It's definitely got a slash Christmas feel to it. But.
Yeah. 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 I mean, you can make the case that this is Bruce Willis's like defining iconic role.
Oh, yeah.
Like this is what he became known for and everything else after that is just some variation off of –
We should mention content. Content plays a role in
major content warning in terms.
Boy, what is it with your movies and content?
Language,
my goodness,
language beyond salty language to just flat out language.
Yep. Yep.
Not one for the kids.
Yep. One. We can't say stuff without putting E's next to the
yes.
to the podcast.
Yes. We were talking about this at Life Group last night, and. My wife has not seen Die Hard in a long time.
She forgot about Yippee-ki-yay?
Well, and I was trying to say – I was like, there's a lot of language. Like I'm warning her like if we watch this, there's a lot of language and not just like salty language but like F-bombs. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, well, what's that? Isn't the famous line Yippee-ki-yay? Like – yes, but
followed
there's
by.
Two more words after that are certainly not safe to repeat on the air.
Mm-hmm.
She's like, oh, I didn't remember that. Yeah, that's kind of an important part of the
– you may have seen it on cable.
Yes, exactly. You may have seen a very sanitized version of it. So yes, Die Hard is a Christmas movie and it did make my list. Next for you.
Nightmare Before Christmas. Have you ever seen this movie?
I have not.
Okay, so this is a Tim Burton –
I've heard of it, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So he did like the 90s Batman movies, Beetlejuice.
Mm-hmm.
But he did this and it's claymation. And it's about this world where these different holidays have these different figures that descend on our world to enact that holiday.
Hmm.
And so this main character, Jack, is part of Halloween. And so he descends on our world to like enact Halloween, scare people, to do things like that. And he's so bored with it after doing it for like 100 years. He's like, I need to discover something else. And he discovers Christmastown and eventually tries to act out, tries to produce Christmas. Hmm. But of course, they do it with like bugs and guts and all these things. And it just goes horribly wrong.
Okay.
It's a great illustration of you were created for certain things. Don't do things you weren't created for.
Okay. That's the philosophical lesson that comes out.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I see.
I do like that movie.
All right. I'm going to go with a classic. My last two are both classics, I would say. It's a Wonderful Life. Jimmy Stewart.
Yep.
I forget what year. I mean, it's black and white. I mean, if that tells you anything. So.
Yeah. Classic movie.
Classic movie. Yeah, it's just one of those things where it gives you a sense of here's a guy who thinks his life is worthless and hasn't had any impact and then is brought to realize actually that's not true.
Hmm.
So classic. It's a Wonderful Life.
My fifth and final one, and I did this through I put this on here because of the influence of my mother wanting this movie shown in our house, I think, every Christmas. Charlie Brown's Christmas, where they give the gospel presentation. What is Christmas really about? Well, it's about Jesus.
Yeah. And I think they read Luke 2 at the end, don't they?
Yes. Yes, they do.
Like they actually just read the scripture account.
Yeah. And up until 2 or 3 years ago, it was on CBS every year.
I think I saw something that this year was the last year that it was on network television this year, but they announced this was going to be the last year.
So I heard – I thought Apple owned it now.
I only saw it on saw it on a social media outlet, so I could be mistaken. But yeah, that's a classic for sure.
For sure. And it's great. It's 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Easily digestible.
Yes. My last one, which is what we watched last night. A Christmas Story.
You'll shoot your eye out,
That's
kid.
That's right. Yes, good old Ralphie.
Fudge.
Yeah, except for I didn't say fudge.
Yeah, boy,
Think – I know, more
swearing,
content.
Yeah.
More content, right? But one of the things that makes me laugh in that movie is he's getting bullied by the kid. And finally, he just snaps and just starts absolutely beating the snot out of the bully. I'm not sure why that makes me laugh so hard, but yeah, just.
I always appreciate the inner dialogue he has where it's like, I triple dog dare you. Ooh, that was a slight breach of etiquette.
Protocol, yeah. Skipping over the triple dare to the triple dog dare. Yeah, my wife's a big fan of the voiceover. I am too.
The leg lamp.
The leg lamp is classic, yeah. It arrives in that big crate that's the size of a refrigerator.
Fragile.
Yeah, I think that's fragile. Yeah.
It must be Italian.
Yes. So, those were we each came up with 5 Christmas movies. Others could have been listed for sure. But
yeah.
And I'm curious to see how Claus.
Yeah. Is it number 5 overall? First of all, I don't think – did we recognize – maybe number 4 we recognize. Maybe let's – you want to tick off the top 5 there?
Yeah, let's do it. So on this list, number 1 – and again, this article is entitled The 100 Best Christmas Movies of All Time. Number 1 was Meet Me in St. Louis from 1944.
I've never seen that.
Never heard of it.
Okay. Next.
Number 2, The Shop Around the Corner from 1940.
Wrong direction. Needs to be more recent.
Never heard of it.
Nope.
Number 3, Miracle on 34th Street, 1947. I have heard of this one.
Not the 1947 version, though.
Okay. Number 4, Tangerine from 2015.
Yeah, I'm reading the synopsis of this, and I don't see the word Christmas.
Yeah. Well, here's what you need to know. About the synopsis. This tells you everything you need to know about the angle. After hearing that her boyfriend slash pimp cheated on her while she was in jail, a transgender
coitus worker
and her best friend And then from there, like, okay, that's all you needed to know. There's a little bit of a political agenda there. Okay, number five.
Also, by the way, Shop Around the Corner.
Yeah.
Starring James Stewart.
Oh, there you go. Number five, Claws, which we mentioned.
We did.
2019. That feels very recent feels to get to recent. Number five. Yeah.
Notice number six there.
The Night Before Christmas. There
93.
You go. Yep. Little Women.
I don't know.
That's not a Christmas
movie.
That
doesn't feel Christmassy. Number eight.
That is a Christmas movie. It's Die Hard.
Die Hard.
Yeah.
Number nine, I've never heard of.
Carol. No, I've never heard of that either.
Number 10.
It's a Wonderful Life. Yeah.
I think classic. That's about as far as we need to go.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. For sure. So, all right. Well, there are some recommendations for holiday viewing that you can enjoy during this fine Christmas season. Are we ready to move on, John?
I think so.
Time now for This Day in Sports History.
Okay, December 13th, 2022, 1936. Speaking of an era where I know none of the Christmas movies from.
Yeah.
The National Football League Championship at the Polo Grounds in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
Green Bay Packers beat the Boston Redskins.
That's right.
21-6 Packers fourth title. Redskins moved to Washington, D.C. for the 37th season.
Beat them so bad they left town.
My goodness. I wish they were in Boston right now, tell you the truth. 1956, Dodgers trade Jackie Robinson to the Giants for pitcher Dick Littlefield and $35,000. Robinson will retire rather than be traded.
Apparently, he did not want to go to the Giants.
That's interesting because he's from that area.
Is he?
Yeah, yeah.
But were they in San Francisco at that point, or were they still in New York? The Giants.
56. They might have been in New York still.
Yeah, that's a California kid.
Yeah, he's from L.A., San Francisco. I mean, somewhere in that state.
Mm-hmm.
1983. 9,655. See the highest scoring NBA game. Detroit scores 186. Denver, 184. Triple overtime.
I feel like that's a record that's ripe to be broken in today's NBA.
Oh, yeah.
Given the amount of scoring there is, it feels to me like that's one that I wouldn't be surprised to see get broken.
Yep. I agree. Also, there was less than 10,000 in attendance.
Yeah, that's pretty uncommon, obviously, today.
Yeah. 1999, the 65th Heisman Trophy Award goes to Wisconsin running back Ron Dane.
Yes.
I don't know much about Ron.
He was a big dude.
Did he have much of an NFL career?
I think he played for the Giants.
Did he?
Yep.
I do not remember him. 2007. The Mitchell Report is publicly released, listing the names of 89 Major League Baseball players that have presumably used anabolic steroids and human growth hormones. Notable players include Roger Clemens and Miguel Tejada.
Nicely done.
Roger Clemens still can't get into the Hall.
Well, and part of what makes this list so challenging is the fact that, like, it's not because that wasn't based on testing, was it? Was it based on testing or was it based on sort of
I don't believe it was
informing,
based on.
Like, yeah. Hey, I saw, you know, Roger inject himself with roids kind of stuff.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Anabolic.
Anabolic. That's the worst kind of steroids.
Yeah.
So you got a preference out of that list?
Oh, my goodness. I kind of like the 1936 NFL championship.
Okay.
At the Polo Grounds.
You want to go Packers over the Boston Redskins?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the Polo Grounds were a famous baseball stadium.
Right.
Where the bullpens, if memory serves, were just on the track in the outfield in fair territory.
That seems like an unwise placement.
It was an option, apparently.
Okay. So you want to go with that?
I mean, I could go with others, but yeah, that one seems to be an interesting one.
Okay.
Because of the Boston Redskins.
All right. I would go with that or the highest scoring game in NBA history.
Up to you.
Yeah, let's go with that. I'm going to overrule you. Be all right with that.
I'm fine with it.
We're going to go with the highest scoring game in NBA history.
That less than 10,000 people saw.
That's right. That's right. One thing you liked.
Andrew and I got an offer accepted on a house. We already mentioned that very early in the pod. But yeah, that feels momentous.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's hope we keep liking it for 30 years, you know.
I'm willing to put a sizable amount of money down right now. You will not stay in that house 30 years.
Okay. Yeah, I'd probably.
Not that I have a sizable amount of money to put down on this.
What about 20 years? 15 years.
So we're setting an over-under on you in that house.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to go.
10 years.
I'm going to go.
2 years.
I'm going to set the over-under at 8.
Yeah, I don't gamble, Matt. I'm sorry.
See, you come from a family that moved like every 3 to 4 years.
Uh-huh.
And so I feel like that sort of – I don't know if there's anything genetic in that, but environmentally wise.
Yeah, the nurture aspect.
Yeah, the itch to move, even within the same city.
Yep.
So, okay. Well, we'll put it down on the podcast
eight years. 8 years.
And when we're still doing podcast in 8 years, I guess we'll have to revisit that.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, who knows what podcast will be like in 8 years?
Odds that we'll still be doing this podcast in 8 years.
That's a good question. I have no clue.
Yeah.
I have no clue. There's a scenario where I see it. Where you and I sit down in front of a microphone every week.
For the next 8 years, even though we've already completed – this is almost the end of year three.
If we hit the decade – maybe we call it quits at a decade.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe we have we send out invites – I don't know how we do this – to everybody who has listened and say, we've been doing this 10 years. Come pay for our podcasting fees.
There you go.
Come do something. Come see us.
Yeah. I'm sure Grace will put a big event on.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll get gold watches or something.
Yeah. Something like that. Something like that. All right. My one thing I liked. Now, last episode I mentioned that it was about to be senior night for Jake in his final basketball season here. And so this episode now happens after the fact. So Jake's basketball career, competitive basketball career is over. But the one thing I liked is – so he had senior night on Monday night of last week and then he had one more game that was a makeup game rescheduled for Wednesday.
Mm.
And we just had a remarkable number of friends from the community come out to watch Jake. People who just came out of appreciation for our family and for Jake, and two of our pastors came.
Yeah, I saw that.
And they only found out about it because my wife was in a women's ministry meeting with their wives like late that afternoon. She mentioned it and they just showed up.
Oh, fun.
And so it was a lot of fun. We had a – we made a big fat head for him.
Hmm.
And so it was a lot of fun. Very bittersweet, very emotional for the Harmon family. There were some tears, but a great experience and a fun memory that we will never forget. So
awesome.
We have talked NFL, the Jets, a second straight loss. We have talked a little World Cup. We have talked favorite Christmas movies, including some with content warnings.
Yours mostly had content warnings.
Okay, but one of mine was one you had on your list that you then took off because it was on my list.
Yes.
Okay.
But it was not on my list.
Because mine was there first.
Yes, but your movies had content warnings.
Okay. We talked about the highest scoring game in NBA history. We talked about getting an offer accepted on a house. We also set odds on how long John Sloat would remain in that house. We set odds on how long the podcast would go. in terms of years. And we talked about great support from friends in the community. So I think, by definition, we have covered our various and sundry topics. And so all that's left to say is, until next time, the Lord bless y'all real good.
Later.